Concurrency control is the last part in our chapter on transaction management. And concurrency control considers the I in ACID, which stands for isolation. Consider in this example three transactions, T1, T2, and T3. And what we want to have in terms of the semantics or the effect of the execution is to have these transactions being evaluated in a sequential single user mode, because this is exactly what isolation means. That every user has a database as if the user is the only user. However, when it comes to the real execution, we want to have concurrent interleaved actions for increased performance of our database system. That means we want to have this one as the actual execution, but the semantic of the sequential we also call serial execution. There are several aspects to consider here. First of all, this is like the beginning of our part now, serializability. Serializability considers different models to decide when a schedule, that means like a sequence consisting of different actions from different transactions, is serializable, that means equivalent to a serial schedule. We will start looking at final state serializability. That's one way to define serializability, and also then on view serializability, and finally on conflict serializability, which you probably all know already from the undergraduate course. Then we have to also see how we are realizing these serializabilities, and we will look here in locking-based approaches and approaches based on timestamp, and with this we also have to look at deadlock management. To recap what we have to avoid in concurrency control, here we see the lost update anomaly. So we have two transactions, T1 and T2, and the time is running here, as you can see, from bottom down. Initially, we have here transaction 1 reading variable x, and then adds 30 to the value of x, and then writes it back. In parallel here in time step 2, after transaction 1 was reading, also transaction 2 is reading, and here is updating x by 20 and writes it back here in timestamp 6, whereas transaction 1 was writing it in timestamp 5. This means that the change that was done by transaction 1, namely here this write, whereas x would be 130 in the database, is overwritten by this write here by transaction 2. So we see that here we have added 30 and here we have added 20, so in everything would work out properly, like in a serial execution, x would be increased by 60, but as we can see here in this example, this 30 here was lost. So in the end, x would be only 120 if it was 100 initially. Hence, this is called lost update anomaly. We can also write it in an inline fashion here, which is the same as the example before, just that we leave out any examples above numbers and actions. But you see the same thing here very well. You're reading from one transaction, then you're reading also in the other transaction, and both of these reads are going for the initial value of x, and then you're writing by transaction 1, and then you're also writing inside transaction 2, and of course this here is lost. And we will later on define classes of schedules, so interleaved actions that we allow in a database. And of course, these classes of schedules that we are allowing in the database should not include schedules that have this loss update anomaly inside. A different anomaly is called inconsistent read. And this is one example of an anomaly where one transaction is only reading, which looks surprising at first, because you would maybe suggest in the beginning that there's no harm done if a transaction is only reading and the other one is interfering with the database. But it's not true, as we can see here. Consider here a banking application with the current account status of X and Y accounts being 50 each. So the consistency constraint we can have in a database would be that X plus Y is 100 in this example. Now transaction 1, which is the one that is only reading from the database, would calculate the sum of x and y, while transaction 2 is transferring a value of 10, let's say euro, from x to y. So here we have initially our internal variable inside transaction 1, which we call sum, and we are reading x, we're reading y, and then we're adding x and y to our variable sum, which is basically only x plus y. In parallel, we have transaction 2 being executed, and initially here in timestamp 1, so before t1 is doing anything, t2 is reading x, subtracting 10 from x, and writing it back. So the value of x, which transaction 1 is seeing in timestamp 4, is x decremented by 10. So it's clear now that the sum, which is calculated here in timestamp or time point 8, is not anymore assuring x plus y equals 100, because this 10 is missing, right? On the other hand, what transaction 2 is doing is still like consistent with our constraint, because before transaction 2 is committing, we have also here the change to variable y, where we're adding the 10 we have just subtracted from x. So after transaction 2 is done, everything is fine when you look at transaction 2 only. But during the evaluation of transaction 2, there was transaction 1 reading some inconsistent state, which is an anomaly, and we should prevent this. Of course, we can also write it down in a more compact way, which we usually do in the following slides. Here in an inline fashion, we read this from left to right, and the same, of course, situation, just without the explicit example, you can also observe here in this schedule. Last, we have the dirty read anomaly, which considers here that we have two transactions, and one transaction is reading and writing. So you're adding here in this example 100 to variable x, and transaction 2 is also reading afterwards the updated value of x, including this 100 which was added, and then is doing some other modification based on this variable x and writing it back. However, here what we observe in timestamp 6 is that we have a failure of transaction 1 and a rollback as a consequence. That means that this variable x, or the value of variable x which was read here in t2 at timestamp 4, was not really, or should not be there, because the actions of t1 are to be made undone when we do a failure handling here. That means this value here shouldn't be read at the first place, which means that this write to variable x is also not valid or not legal, let's say. And this example is not only interesting because of this situation, that we are modifying some variable value which we should not even have read at the first place, but it's also interesting to see what we have to do in order to make some recoverable solution, or some solution which is consistent when we're handling this failure. Because if you're looking at this situation now, we can still fix it, right? Because when we have here the failure at times 0.6, we could just say, okay, t2 also needs to be reset. So this would not happen, and we would also issue here a rollback. So this, like what we later on see, this we call a cascade of abort, because following this abort, also other transactions, t2 in this case, needs to be aborted. We have, however, a big problem, assuming that we have the following situation. Let me just modify a little bit this example. So we have here 8, 9, and let's say in time point 9, we have a rollback, a failure and a rollback. And here in time point 8, we have a commit. Now this means that transaction 2 is committed, and the user would walk back from, let's say, the ATM or any other application, and would assume that because of the commit in timestamp 8, the database guarantees durability, so this change has an effect which will be forever in the database. However, after this commit in timestamp 9, the rollback comes of transaction 1, which means everything here has to be made undone. But how can we make this undone? If we make this undone, we also have to make this undone. But we cannot make this undone because we have already committed, right? In this case, we say this schedule is not recoverable. And this is something we should avoid. This is cascading aborts. That's just an unfortunate performance wasting behavior or situation, to be more precise. But this one here, that we have non-recoverable schedules, that's something which is something we have to avoid in the database for to make it operate correctly. Looking at the big picture, where concurrency control is placed in the database system, consider this illustration. We have here different transactions which are operating with the database through the so-called transaction manager. The transaction manager receives from the transactions the individual steps which are to be executed next and forwards these steps to the scheduler. And the scheduler has to make sure that the actions, so the operations from the individual transactions, are executed in a way that does not have any anomalies inside. Once the scheduler decides that these actions are okay regarding our class of schedules we are allowing, which do not have these anomalies, then these actions will be passed on to the data manager, which is then doing the actual actions on the database, of course, including buffer management that we have seen already, and also including recovery management. More precisely, the actions performed by the scheduler are the following. The scheduler, first of all, as I said, receives the steps from the transaction manager. These are read-write requests, abort and commit requests, and then has to decide if these actions, if appended to the schedule, so the sequence of the actions from also from other transactions, is leading to a serializable schedule that belongs to the class of schedules we want to have in our database. In case everything is fine, the scheduler will output the step to the further below component of the database, which is then executing the action. In this case, we say the step is appended to the output schedule. Of course, the output schedule is empty in the beginning. In case the action cannot be executed, so it's not appended because it would make the schedule non-serializable, the action is rejected, in which case then the transaction is aborted and needs to be restarted at a later time point. There's also the possibility to block the action from being appended and is reconsidered later on if the current appending would cause the schedule to be problematic, let's say, in terms of deadlocks or serializability. There are optimistic and pessimistic schedulers, and the scheduler that you probably have already seen in the undergraduate course, two-phase locking, is considered a pessimistic scheduler. The goals we have in the following classes is, first of all, a formal investigation of different classes of schedules. And in order to understand in more detail which of these classes are prohibiting which anomalies, and also looking at the efficiency of a potential scheduler that is operating to achieve these schedules in the individual classes. We will not yet look at how these individual schedules are implemented in terms of coming up with a scheduler, a protocol. We will come to this later on. First of all, we will only look at classes of schedules and their properties.